As usual, I am very happy to welcome you all once again to this lecture course on string theory, right? And I hope all of us together we learn something. Yes? Very good. And I think Lambert missed the class last time, but because as usual we recap a few crucial points every day before we start on the new thing. So really it becomes a continuous story of what we have been doing and what we start doing. We never come to know where we left and where we begin, right? Okay, so in fact we are right now talking about the things which are the soul of string theory, essentially, because these concepts that we discuss in this lecture, last lecture, this lecture and so on, this really makes the core of string theory topic as such. So let's then, essentially the equations of motion and these solutions of these equations of motions, we are still a little bit far from attacking the solution of these problems, but we are really trying to prepare ourselves to how effectively we can handle, because they contain rich physics and how we could extract the physics out of it. Okay, and how do we impose different boundary conditions on our given situation, on our given problem, and that distinguishes between different strings, open strings of different kinds, what kinds of things we have, both ends fixed, one end fixed, etc., etc. And so on the one hand, let me draw a diagram here, and when we proceed to solve our equations, we keep this simple figure in our mind, simple diagram in our mind, Here, I will come back to it again, but I just wish to tell that in one of these, both of them correspond to upper string. Both of them correspond to open string examples. In one case, I fixed the two ends of the string so that no variation is allowed here. The variation of this coordinate vanishes, variation of this coordinate vanishes because this is fixed at a particular value. It need not be same, it can be anywhere. Okay, but it's fixed. This is what we would refer to as the Dirichlet boundary condition. And this is different one. Here we call it Neumann boundary conditions. Here the ends are not fixed at a point, they can fluctuate, they can move around. So here delta x is not zero. Here also delta x is not zero. However, when we impose this, we additionally demand that x prime or the space derivative of x nu equal to zero in this case. And here, now, we come back to it a little bit later. But this is what we keep in mind. And how do we come to this point? So we then start, our starting point is again the action and the equation of motion. So we take the Polyakov action minus d by 2. D2 sigma square root of minus h alpha beta d alpha beta, and then we take h alpha beta to be equal to eta alpha beta minus 1 0 0 1. And this would also be equal to, because the inverse of this matrix is the same as the matrix itself. So the inverse of this matrix is the same. This is the inverse of this. This is the inverse of this. But because of a particular value of this matrix, its inverse remains the same as the matrix itself. And so this is where we simplify it, and this is mu, and this is equal to theta of the sigma into minus x dot square plus x prime square. Here x dot square is x dot mu, x prime square is x prime mu, x prime mu. Okay? And then we now know it fairly well, this action. In the conformal gauge fixing, eventually reduces to this when we transform our auxiliary field from a curved metric to a flat metric. Okay, and now, so the point is, now we want to have the variational principle we want to make use of, and this gives us delta of delta x mu, and or delta x mu And because this guy is non-zero, we have, or we could, this is non-zero, therefore we have delta x over delta x mu equal to 0. And this variation delta s from here could easily be written as p or p by 2 into b tau d sigma of x mu dot delta x mu dot minus x prime delta x prime mu. Okay, this minus sign if taken inside, this gives you plus of x dot square, which is the kinetic energy and which is positive. So this is perfectly fine. And then we know that this could be written as del tau of delta x mu, and this could be written as del sigma of del x mu. Why? Because these two operations, delta and del tau, del sigma and del, they are infinitesimal operations, and I can approximately take them to be the same.